watching sports with Ben Rosehart.
He will always be someone I admire in this industry, a true trailblazer, and a great reminder to always be yourself. Is it better to have loved and lost than to have never loved at all? In her first public appearance in the Quad Cities since the Australian Open, Rock Island native Madison Keys says she expects to one day join the Williams sisters as a winner of a Grand Slam event.
In a game of Scrabble, these kids have found the winning combination. Now that's what I call a triple word score.
The one person who's not down here at the starting line who's going to be running today, that is Bettendorf's own Kathy Schmidt. The last two John Deere Classic winners have fallen into the sand on the 18th hole, but then used that as a launching pad to victory. But now he's making a move on the back nine. He had an eagle on 14.
Ben Rosehart would not eat green eggs and ham.
He would not eat them, Sam, I am.
He would not eat them all alone. But I will eat them if you...
I think I'm going to learn how to slam dunk before the season's over.
With or without the trampoline?
Well, we'll see.
The Nittany Lions like to gamble a little bit on fourth down, and there's a method to their madness.
You're watching sports with Ben Rosehart.
No wonder Fran the Man is upset. His Hawkeyes just absolutely dismantled the 17th-ranked team in the country, but Adam Woodbury is the center of attention for one particular play. Woodbury and the Hawkeyes trying to earn win number 1,000 for the program. Maryland played so poorly they might not be ranked for very long. Early on, it's Woodbury with the kiss off the glass. He had 16 points. More on him in just a second. Always love it when Mike Gazelle breaks out a Rondo-like ball fake, and that helps Gabe Olushanye get open. He gets two and one to go. Hawkeyes build a crazy 24-5 lead. That's pretty ridiculous. Later in the first half, it's Pokegate 3.0. Melo Trimble gets hit in the eye. Hawkeyes have numbers the other way. It eventually leads to a wide-open three-pointer by Jared Utoff. He buries it. Iowa up 28-12. Maryland playing awful, but their coach, Mark Turgeon, he wants to know what happened there. Let's take another look. This is the third time Woodbury has poked a player in less than 3 weeks. He was called for a flagrant this time, unlike the previous two against Wisconsin. It's a shame, though, that that moment overshadows an amazing effort by the Hawkeyes. Aaron White scores 17. Iowa led by 23 at halftime, and it was all black and gold. 71-55 the final. Iowa earns its fourth win over a ranked opponent. Woodbury finishes with 16 points, 5 boards, and 1 poke. And unfortunately, that big win takes a back seat to comments made by Coach Fran McCaffrey.
That's 3 times he's got somebody in the eye. How does this keep happening? Or...
Next question. Ask an intelligent question. Anybody have a question?
Well, why is that not an intelligent question?
Because I said so.
He drove into me. I tried to usually guys bring the ball right in front of him. I was trying to swipe down with the ball. He put his head in there. I talked to him about it. He didn't seem to have a problem with it at all. And it's part of the game, man. Savvy got hit in the mouth. Nobody said anything. Whitey got hit in the face. Nobody said anything. No, I mean, I get hit in the mouth, hit in the face all the time. It's just part of the game. Game's going real fast. Those guys are real quick. I mean, if anybody thinks I'm doing that intentional in front of that many people on that big stage, I don't know what to say to them.
Iowa returns to action this Thursday when Minnesota visits Iowa City. Less than 24 hours after celebrating Senior Day, the Ashford Saints spoiled the Senior Day festivities for St. Ambrose. Ashford coach Oliver Drake won his 100th game on Saturday, and the Saints go marching out to a 14-point lead right away. Diamante McKinley works around the pick by Dominique Walls. Appropriate last name for a big man. McKinley at 21. A couple possessions later, it's McKinley over to Anthony Woods. Ashford still in front by 13. He hit that one from downtown Davenport. Late in the first half, it's United Township alum Damon Overton breaking out the crossover. He drives and thrives. He had 18 off the bench. St. Ambrose still down by double digits. They make a late push, though, from the outside. It's Jordan Heatherton knocking down the three. And then just seconds later, Ambrose again attacking. It's Ty McLean. He's going to join the three party, but it's too little too late as the Saints get the victory 86-72. Congrats to Nick Frazier. Becomes just the fifth Ambrose player to score 2,000 career points. Another action, the Queen Bees sting Ashford 66-48. Samantha Logic with 30. And the 16th-ranked Iowa women top Wisconsin. Illinois and Western Illinois women both lose close ones on the road. Both All-Stars on the Bulls played fantastic against the Orlando Magic. Jimmy Butler with the throwdown here. He had 27 points. Bulls up 32-16 after the opening quarter, but down by one in the final 15 seconds. It's Derrick Rose trying to be the hero. No, but Pau Gasol, yes, he has the bailout plan. Gasol, 25 points, 15 boards, and 1 game winner. Bulls win 98 97 for Gasol. That's his 12th double-double in a row. He leads the NBA with 33. Iowa and Penn State have combined to win the last seven NCAA wrestling championships, with the Nittany Lions winning the past four. The top-ranked Hawkeyes certainly had something to prove as they went toe-to-toe with the defending champions. Tom Brands and Kale Sanderson wondering how their squads would match up out in State College, PA. 14th-ranked Michael Kelly, very tough to beat at 157. Here's why. Battles back from a 2-0 deficit to earn a 7-4 victory, and that would give the Hawkeyes a 12-3 advantage. Later, it's Penn State rallying behind Garrett Hammond and this takedown of Nick Moore. Penn State pulls within six with football coach James Franklin on hand. Standing ovation for that W, with Iowa only up 15-12 into the last match. It's the Hawkeye heavyweight Bobby Telford up against Penn State's Jimmy Lawson. But he tells it like it is, and Telford gets a 3-0 victory. Iowa remains undefeated with an 18-12 win. Hawkeyes earned their seventh regular season conference title in 8 years. Before starting an 8-game homestand, the Chicago Blackhawks need to close out their 7-game road trip on a high note against the St. Louis Blues. As seen right here on NBC earlier today, the Blackhawks were the team that would strike first in the opening period. It's Marcus Kruger, no relation to Freddie Orlan. He lights the lamp, 1-0 Chicago after one. We're tied at two, though, in the third. 8 minutes and change to go on the power play. It's Brandon Saad finding Marian Hossa, the Haas. He had two goals in this one. That one was the key one, though, because under 3 minutes to go, Corey Crawford comes up huge with another big save to preserve that lead. And after an empty netter by Hossa, the Blackhawks do get it done. 4-2, the final. Blackhawks will host Phoenix on Monday. And while the Quad City Mallards were down in Missouri, but it was a tough ride home as they lose 3-0. And last but certainly not least, West Burlington native Miranda Kramer tossed a no-hitter for Western Kentucky on Saturday. Kramer finishes with a school record 19 strikeouts and just the eighth no-hitter in that college's history. Every year around Father's Day for the past decade or so, four generations of golfers gather in Muscatine and hit the links. On Wednesday, we caught up with the Rhodes family, who understands that your game can get better with age because of the people you play with.
When we play together, it's always for fun, nothing serious.
It's a special Father's Day foursome. The ringleader, Dusty Rhodes, who technically lives on the outskirts of Davenport near Bluegrass. His second home, the Muscatine Municipal Golf Course.
It keeps me going. I'm 86 years old, and I don't think I'd be moving now if I didn't play golf.
He says he's 86, and sometimes that could be his age and his score.
I love the game of golf, and what makes golf is the people you play with. You can have fun. I'd rather play, have a bad day and enjoy the people, and have a good day and have one bad guy.
Sometimes the best Father's Day present can be your time. Just ask Dusty's son, Gary.
Dad's amazing. His whole life is about golf. And the thing about it is, every time I play with him and step on this golf course, it's just such a joy, and it's a great time to spend time together.
Over the years, each father in the Rhodes family has passed his love of golf down to his son.
I've been playing golf with my grandfather since I was a teenager, about my son's age, actually. It's such a rare thing to see and be a part of that, you know, I want to share this with my son and my other kids, because it's something that's important to me, family, enjoying the game of golf, having a good time. It's always funny when we go out with my grandfather, so.
My dad made me caddy for him once, and I was kind of still skeptical, but I played a little bit that time, and I actually grown to love the game.
Hopefully he carries it on, and maybe we can do this in the future, you know, when he has a kid, and that would be totally awesome, so.
Yeah, but they didn't sponsor you either.
Gary also has a twin brother that lives in Florida, so Dusty is actually getting two rounds of golf in with his family this week.
They tell me whether I got on or not, or whether I'm short or long, or how close I am. I got a lot of eyes down here.
All the guys told me all four of them are still looking for that elusive first hole-in-one.
KWQC's Ben Rosehart has much more from Kinnick.
Despite four turnovers in the first half, the Hawkeyes still built a 17-point advantage in the third quarter. Usually that's more than enough to hold on for a victory, but Nebraska was able to score quickly through the air and on special teams.
We had our opportunities, no question about that, but you know, the two things that really cost us today were the turnovers and then errors or misgivings in the special teams area, and that I'm not going to say it came as a surprise. We had we thought that returner was as dangerous of a guy as we've seen this season.
You know, we had turnovers. Just didn't play well enough in, as an offensive unit out there. Caught too many three and outs in that second half. That's basically like a turnover almost. Probably could have put them to bed maybe, but, you know, we let them stay in it. They stuck in it. They played better than us in that second half, and they beat us.
A potential knockout blow came in the third quarter when Rudock overthrew Damon Powell for what should have been a touchdown.
I mean, we felt confident, but, you know, as an offense, we weren't putting points on the board. And we knew that. We knew we had to, hey, we have to go do something about it. And unfortunately, we weren't able to do that until a little too late.
We kept fighting. You know, they just made, Nebraska's a good team. They make plays. So, no, there's no letting up in us, you know. They found some holes in our defense, and they exposed it.
It just sucks because we didn't, our record doesn't show how good of a team we are, because we are a really good team. And, you know, like I said earlier, we just didn't win the winnables, the games that we should have won. And, you know, today was another one of those.
At 7-5, the Hawkeyes still have one more opportunity to send the seniors out with a victory. And one source tells me they might end up playing at the 49ers' new stadium out in Santa Clara. In Iowa City, Ben Rosehart, KBQC TV6 Sports.